One of the writers who's meant most to me over the years has been the Russian novelist Dostoevsky, whom I first read when I was a student, and later on did some work on and wrote a book about. I suppose what impresses me most about Dostoevsky is something he said himself about his own work, that he believed that as a Christian, he could put the case against God and against faith even more strongly than an atheist could. And in his last and probably his greatest work, The Brothers Karamazov, he quite deliberately sets out to show that being a Christian doesn't mean you have to close your eyes to the horrors and outrages of the world. So he's got a long chapter about the horrors of children suffering, and a long chapter about how perhaps freedom isn't good for us, and perhaps we'd be better off as slaves or automata. And for him, the answer is simply that love is real, love is embodied, that there is never a human situation which is without hope. And part of what he's trying to speak about is not, again, something that makes suffering less important. It's really to put into relief just how much love, just how much profoundly sacrificial love is called out from us in a world where suffering is so deep and so appalling. So that's part of what he's trying to do. He's inviting us to think what it might mean, as he likes to say, to take responsibility for the world we're in. And all his great novels are in one way or another about that taking of responsibility. And the characters who are for him rather fishy, rather unsatisfactory, are the characters who one way or another walk away from that responsibility, the characters who try to manipulate other people and control them rather than take loving responsibility for them, the characters who brush it all off and live for pleasure and self. So his novels are a very deep gospel-shaped challenge for me. They're also, of course, brilliant in their psychological insight, in their sheer literary quality, the style, the imagery, the physical vividness of descriptions, and that great sense you have in him of three-dimensional characters coming through all the time. It's been a very important part of my own exploration as a theologian, as a Christian teacher, to go on engaging with those stories and find myself again and again rediscovering some very, very basic things about Christian faith. Dostoevsky was, of course, a Russian Orthodox Christian, and part of his inheritance as a Russian Christian was, I think, a quite strong sense of how God comes through to us, not as commanding, overriding, dominating, but always in humility, always in the disguise of the humblest. It's a theme that comes again and again in Russian literature, especially in the 19th century, but also the 20th, that you may expect to find God in humble form, in the faces and the lives of the poorest and the excluded. And that particularly Russian emphasis on the humility, and even the humiliation of God as God comes to us in Jesus, that runs right through his novels in all kinds of ways, as does the theme of responsibility and shouldering each other's burdens. And you can see a great deal of Dostoevsky's writing as a sort of long commentary on that theme of shouldering each other's burdens, and that other theme of Christ not grasping at security, but reaching out to us in his insecurity. In The Brothers Karamazov, Dostoevsky imagines one of the brothers, the middle brother of the three brothers of the title, Ivan, who is an atheist, or at least an agnostic, protesting about the world. He says, I'm going to give the ticket back. I don't want to belong to this universe, a universe in which children suffer without rhyme or reason. And Dostoevsky lays out that challenge very, very fully. And the only answer that's given is, well, there are perhaps two answers that are given. One is that at the end of his great tirade against God and the Church, his brother Alyosha, the monastic novice, simply embraces him, kisses him. The other answer is what happens with the eldest brother, Mitya, later in the book, where Mitya, accused of a murder he didn't commit, accepts the guilt for the murder because he feels that he has got to take responsibility for a world in which evil happens, and that that utterly generous and sacrificial act of taking the blame is his way of doing something for a world of injustice. So the answers given to the great protests that Ivan enters, and the chapter in which these are described is called Rebellion in the novel, the answer is in the narratives. It's in what actually happens, what people grow into as they evolve in the course of the novel. It would be a very different novel if at the end of that chapter on rebellion, Alyosha or another character said, well, let me explain to you, it's this, this, and this, and that's it, because you'd then have another 450 pages or so without very much happening.